Welcome to the brand new third, fourth, what season is this? It doesn't matter. The only difference between the third season and the fourth season is a remix of our theme song from Preacher Boy. Download and listen to more music from our Cinema Shame house artist at preacherboy.com. My name is James Patrick. You can send me all of your disagreeable tweets at 007hertzrumble on the Twitter. Cinema Shame lives on the web at cinemashame.wordpress.com. Your movie watching prompt for May is to pick a movie off your own shelf that you've owned for 5 years but still haven't watched. Share your cinematic conquests with us at Cinema Shame on Twitter. My guest today is Eric Jones, a man of style and class, creator of the movie blog Deacon's Den and co-host of Waxing Cinematic Podcast. You can follow him on Twitter at Deacon050C. Eric has been a longtime contributor behind the scenes for Cinema Shame as our quality control expert, and today he's going to do us the honor of giving us a flyby with a conversation about Top Gun. No matter what you think you've seen, you'll find it's not enough. No matter what you think you know, you won't get through. Lordy, it's a cinephilic quirk to rise your spark above the kirk. But no matter where you hide or what you're more than you, no matter how that film is shown, what always sounds the same. The screen with five stain with no town. Well, you can figure it for real as you pick up every heel. But man, what you do, they're gonna take you down. Lordy, it's a shame down, blame town.
Top Gun came out in 86. I was born in 85. However, I was always exposed to it because we had the VHS in the house. So as I was growing up, the VHS was there. And I don't know why I never, you know, as I'm growing up and, you know, more and more movies I'm discovering, you know, I'm discovering Bond, you know, I'm a Bond fan like you, Bondage and all of that.
Well, that's how we got connected originally was through the James Bond social media project, the Bondage live tweets and everything. So, yep. Yeah, Bond runs deep here. So when I heard you that you had not seen Top Gun, I was personally shocked and horrified, and I knew that we had to get you on to discuss it.
Yeah, like I said, the VHS was in our house for years, and it was almost like the FedEx package for Tom Hanks in Castaway. It was there, and I don't know why all these years, like. I remember when my parents bought Unforgiven and I was so excited to watch that. And I just kept passing Top Gun. I don't know why. You see it there and it's just one of those things that, and I didn't even really know what, you know, growing up, like what Top Gun really was as far as, you know, as a, not just as a movie, but, you know, as a cultural thing, especially as I've discovered through my first time watching of it. But yeah, it was always there, and I just never watched it. I just don't know why. And it's not even like it wasn't something that wouldn't interest me. That type of movie. I'm a fan of Tony Scott, the late Tony Scott. I'm also a fan of Jerry Bruckheimer. So all those elements were right there as something that I would have loved to watch. And I just don't know why I never put it on. I like Tom Cruise. I just don't understand why that one, for some reason, I missed over the years. And the only reason why it managed to pop up is when you were selling some of your old DVDs and stuff, and Top Gun was one of them. And I was just like, oh yeah, you know what? Let me just buy Top Gun because I ain't seen it yet. So that's how all things worked out.
So Top Gun, like a lot of these movies we talk about on here, it kind of takes over. It was such a cultural flashpoint when it came out, not just in theaters, but like you're talking about that VHS tape. The VHS tape was another one of those milestones for home video. Everybody had the Top Gun VHS tape.
Yeah, I was as I was just reading just on Wikipedia and all that, and that was something I wasn't aware of, how it was one of the first blockbusters that, because the in the VHS market at that time was still, new and everything, and how just on Wikipedia here it says it was the first new release blockbuster on video cassette to be priced as low as $26.95. And I was a VHS person, girl. VHS was my original medium for movies. Obviously, as I'm sure you know, so $26.95 at the time, that's everybody's like, oh, that's a good deal.
Your VCR, Top Gun, buy it for the unbelievable price of $26.95. Tom Cruise in the video cassette premiere of Top Gun from Paramount.
I would imagine that, and it said it was released March 10th, 1987 on VHS. So I was only 2 years old. Well, actually, I wasn't even 2 years old yet then. But, I would imagine that for my parents, at the time, that's probably when my father, most likely it was my father, who bought the VHS. And, I mean, well, I know why he bought it. Top Gun is a it's a military Navy movie. My father was in the Navy, so it's something that it's a little close to home for him. So, but yeah, that it was just I was just surprised because it was just one of those things that I just when I watched it and I realized that I was like, this isn't just a Top Gun's a lot of things. Like it's not like as you're like
There's a
it's
lot
not
of things. Yeah.
like it's it's an action movie, it's a romance movie, it's a personal drama, it's also kinda and I'm just trying to think, correct me if you think there are other movies that might have might fit this mold a little better, but I actually think it might be the quintessential movie of the 1980s. Like the movie that, and we all know that the 80s had was a great time for movies, but Top Gun seems like it's the one 80s movie that is the perfect distillation of everything about the 80s, whatever you think that positive, negative, whatever, to me it's the perfect, it's like a it's a pure 80s
It's
movie.
the purest essence. I think that's probably a pretty good description because there's a lot of people too. I've actually been surprised at the number of conversations I've had recently with people who have said they haven't seen it because it's precisely how you describe it. Like it's so 80s it hurts. And I will not hide my affection for movies of the 80s. Good, bad, terrible. Like Hollywood productions of the 80s had a certain quality to them. Top Gun is it is a lot of style over substance. I mean, let's not pretend that there's anything that's too deep about Top Gun, first of all. But what it's doing a lot of interesting things that I don't think people give it credit for because of its status as the perhaps considered the ultimate 80s movies because of Tom Cruise, because of the little things they know about the movie. And I think let's get back to that in a minute because I also wanted to talk about how the thing got made in the first place of an unusual partnership between Hollywood and the US military service. And that makes it stand out in and of itself because it sort of represents this pro-military message. And I even have I went to high school, a friend of mine was obsessed with Top Gun. He could quote the whole thing line by line, unprompted, and always wanted to be a Navy pilot because of it. So, spoiler, we'll flash forward. He eventually did become exactly what he wanted to be. So there is this recruitment angle to it. And I'm sure that it was quite effective. So the Paramount paid as much as $7,800 per hour for fuel and other operating costs whenever aircraft are flown outside the normal duties. They had the full cooperation of the U.S. military. But, you know, Tony Scott wasn't all that interested. He wanted the look and he wanted the realism. So while it has that element to it, this army recruitment, pro-military, I've always felt that this is as much Tony Scott exerting his ability to make something that is visceral and real. Because what you're getting with Top Gun is what Top Gun is. It's corny, and there's a lot of moments that you just can't believe that they put into a mainstream Hollywood movie. But above all else, it has this realism to it, because there are real people flying jets. There's no CGI, and there's no camera swooping around a blue screen actor in a cockpit. Like, these are real people flying these planes and real people operating the aircraft carriers that they're shooting. And Tony Scott was shooting live as they are going through their military operations. And that's what makes it stand out for me in terms of its entertainment value. There's really nothing else like it.
Even though, there's this obvious, blood brothership between, the movie and the military. It's funny, because to me, I never really got that, that vibe that, I can see where it would probably definitely have an impact on, on military recruiting and things like that, during 86, the year of his release and all that. But for example, I think about military movies post 9/11, and how they sort of even the ones that you might consider good, but sometimes, at least for me, when I watch some of them, I never can fully just shake that almost sort of I don't even know how to really describe it, but I think you get where I'm going. But for some reason, I don't know, Top Gun still feels sincere. Like, it never feels like it's trying to manipulate a viewer with any sort of heavy-handed militaristic leanings.
Doesn't have
or
sort of the
like
same.
That.
I don't get the sense it has the same sort of jingoism that you accuse something like
that's
Red,
sort of yeah,
Red,
that's
like
sort of
Red Dawn, But even that gets tossed around a lot for Red Dawn, and that does some interesting things that I don't think it gets credit for either. There's, as soon as you bring the military into as a focal point for a Hollywood film, there's always that sensationalist tendency to label it a recruitment video or a propaganda video. And sometimes they are. I mean, sometimes there's a clear method behind it. Movies have a tendency to inspire us in all kinds of different ways. And I see that angle, but it's also not the jingoist movie that a lot of people want to label it.
I'm going to send you up against the best.
Yes, sir.
You two characters are going to Top Gun.
I feel the need for speed.
5 weeks, you're going to fly against the best fighter pilots in the world.
You guys really are cowboys.
I don't like you because you're unsafe.
That's right.
I am dangerous.
The wild card flies by the seat of his pants.
Yeah, I guess when I see something, I go right after it.
It takes a lot more than just fancy flying.
Film in this school is about combat. There are no points for second place.
Figured it out yet?
What's that?
Who's the best pilot?
No, I think I can figure that one out on my own.
Tom Cruise, Kelly McGillis. Top Gun.
Top Gun was released May 16th, 1986. As we mentioned, it was directed by Tony Scott. Written by Jim Cash and Jack Epps Jr. They also wrote Secret of My Success, if you want another point of reference. Epps actually attended a bunch of the declassified Top Gun classes and went for ride-alongs in an F-14 to get a better idea of how to sell this on screen. It was based on an article called Top Guns by Ehud Yonah in a California magazine that detailed the life of fighter pilots at the Naval Air Station Miramar in San Diego. The other fact that I dug up is that Matthew Modine turned down the role of Maverick because the film's pro-military stance went against his politics, he said.
Ah,
it does make sense, but it's a fun exercise then to wonder,
yeah,
what does Matthew Modine's career look like if he takes Top Gun, and what does Tom Cruise's look like? Because this is the movie Tom Cruise had been relevant, but Top Gun made him Tom Cruise. Tom Cruise is such a controversial figure, and it's hard for me to hate him because he is such a charismatic on screen persona, and it all began here. So what do you think? Where does Matthew Modine go? Because I don't even see him. He doesn't have the same personality.
No, and Top Gun is 86, and Full Metal Jacket was 87.
Yeah.
So that definitely would have been, an interesting, an interesting switch. Matter of fact, let's just assume it was, there's a switch for a second because Modine does Top Gun, and Tom Cruise, works with Stanley Kubrick and does Full Metal Jacket. I think Cruise is probably still going to become a superstar. And like you said, Modine doesn't necessarily, while a decent actor, but he doesn't possess that, like you said, that charisma. He just doesn't have that one extra thing that, Cruise has.
Is there something wrong?
Yes, ma'am. The data on the MiG is inaccurate.
How's that, Lieutenant?
Well, I just happened to see a MiG-28. We happened to see a MiG-28 do a 4G negative dive.
Where did you see this?
That's classified.
It's what?
It's classified. I could tell you, but then I'd have to kill you.
Lieutenant, I have top secret clearance. The Pentagon sees to it that I know more than you.
Oh, ma'am, it doesn't seem so in this case now, does it?
So, Lieutenant, where exactly were you?
Well, we... Thank you. Started up on his six when he pulled through the clouds, and then I moved in above him.
Well, if you were directly above him, how could you see him?
Because I was inverted.
Wilson! No, he was, man. It was a really great move. He was inverted.
You were in a 4G inverted dive with the MiG-28?
Yes, ma'am.
At what range?
No, about 2 meters.
Well, it's actually about 1.5, I think. It was 1.5. I've got a great Polaroid of it. And he's right there. Must be 1.5.
It was a nice picture. It wasn't half. Thanks.
Lieutenant, what were you doing there?
Communicating.
Keeping up foreign relations. I was, giving him the bird.
You know, the finger.
Yes, I know the finger, Goose.
I'm sorry, I hate it when it does that. I'm sorry. Excuse me.
So you're the one.
Yes, ma'am.
A funny thing about Cruise in this, one of the things that I think people always will criticize Tom Cruise about is they always say that Tom Cruise doesn't actually act. He only just plays Tom Cruise. And actually with this, and because I haven't watched a whole lot of his early, you know, his early career. But one thing I kind of noticed in this, and which I've kind of noticed in a lot of his stuff, he plays vulnerable really well. And I think that has to do with the charisma. I buy into that face. But yeah, with like Modine, I don't think Modine would have, you might have gotten a better acting performance maybe, but I don't think you would have, you just well, wouldn't have gotten
that. Do we want?
True.
Do we want a more professional actor in this role?
And that's true. When, I mean, the nexus of what's, you know, what's here, you know, you got Tony Scott, you got producers like Don Simpson and Jerry Bruckheimer. This thing kind of, you know, the movie itself kind of begs for a superstar, and, you know,
it needs that superstar personality. His performance was criticized. I read a number of reviews that said that when Goose dies, you don't care because neither actor can sell the tragedy.
You know, I didn't think of that as I was watching it, but now that you say it, I just, you know, you're right. I really didn't care.
No,
I didn't realize that I didn't care, because it's just like when I'm watching and just like, oh, I was like, oh, okay. I was like, all right, Goose died, you know.
It's sad, you know.
it is, but like, and I don't know if it's because of the way the movie just kind of moves on from it, but
yeah, everybody just moves on. I mean, it is a sad scene, and it is the end to a sparkling bromance. I mean, it is the real relationship in the movie. It's it's not Tom Cruise and Kelly McGillis. That is there. It's never really believable that they were together. There's not a whole lot of chemistry, and so we're left with this love affair between Maverick and Goose. And, you know, that should be the central drama of the movie. And then the movie moves on because it has to. It's not in the business of making us feel that way for very long anyway. It wants us to feel like we got like our toes stubbed or something. And
well, we have to move on then to the new relationship, you know, which is Maverick and Iceman.
Hey, day one too, man.
That's not what I heard.
Well, we did. We got Jester.
No. Below the hard deck does not count.
Hard deck my ass. We nailed that son of a bitch. Ha!
You guys really are cowboys.
What's your problem, Kazansky?
You're everyone's problem. That's because every time you go up in the air, you're unsafe. I don't like you because you're dangerous.
That's right. Ice, man, I am dangerous.
Maverick, you and Goose get your butts out of that flight gear and up to Viper's office now.
Because Val Kilmer is an interesting character in this movie. He's presented as sort of an ersatz villain, but what does he do that's villainous?
The only thing that he does is that he calls out Maverick for his recklessness, which is true. Right. So I thought that was an interesting it's an interesting approach. You know, they're trying to make it like he's this, you know, this major rival to him. I mean, they are rivals in a way, but I mean, he's not wrong, you know.
No, he's not wrong.
That's Maverick's reputation, you know, precedes him and everything. The truth is, he really kind of, Maverick, that is, deserves it because he's reckless anyway.
This movie made $176 million in the U.S. It was the number one grossing film of 1986. It made $356.8 million worldwide. And it's a movie, a big Hollywood blockbuster action movie without a villain.
Yeah, it's just all about, it's pretty much just about this one man trying to prove himself
He's got to overcome his demons. He's got to prove himself to himself. It's not even like he has to prove himself to anybody else. Everybody already respects his abilities. He's got to get his head together and believe that he's everything he says he is. And that's it. I mean, can you think of another Hollywood movie of a mainstream blockbuster nature like this that does anything remotely similar? I mean, you could talk about Bond and like the latest iteration where he's constantly fighting his past and his demons. But even there, you're presenting a new villain that is a big bad every outing. It's not like there's any sort of confusion there.
Yeah, and I was just trying to think of, you know, any other, at least anything in the 80s that might have done it. I was, for like half a second, I was going to say Back to the Future, but I just totally forgot Biff Tannen, like, you know, stereotypical of villains in Biff Tannen. So, yeah, that's a very fascinating point that a blockbuster managed to do that.
The closest thing I could think of as I spent all of 10 minutes today between wrangling children with their schoolwork was that I came up with Rocky. Right. But even that, I have a big problem calling Rocky a blockbuster, because this is my minor quibble with the term. Maybe it's more than a minor quibble, because I complain about it all the time. I don't think you can call something a blockbuster that has no expectation of making money. Like, Rocky was independently financed. It wasn't expected to do anything. It just latched on to a zeitgeist and became something that nobody could have predicted. I don't think you can label something a blockbuster in retrospect just because it made a ton of money. Something like Top Gun, which is clearly designed to make a ton of money at the box office, that's a blockbuster. And that's why I think this is interesting in that it does something like this.
I don't think the current cinematic marketplace would allow for.
They never spend this kind of money on this kind of movie. I mean, that this is something that really went out the window when the 1990s arrived.
Yeah. I mean, the only reason why and what it took until, well, now we were supposed to get it in June, but now we won't be getting it until December. You know, we finally get our
sequel. We finally get the sequel. Does that surprise you?
I was honestly surprised that they managed to get a sequel. You know, one, I really never realized, and maybe it's just because I hadn't seen Top Gun, so I didn't know, you know, what the desire for it was. When I found out there was one, I was like, oh wow, I guess I really do need to watch Top Gun now. But I never realized that it was something that people, you know, sort of wanted. Also didn't even really think that, you know, when I watched it, it's like, you know, this really didn't necessarily have to be a story that, you know, that you continued. But, you know, I'm eager to check it out all the same.
I'm definitely eager. I think the distance is good for this movie. I don't think a sequel would have played well, and I never wanted one. But this far removed, honestly, you know, I was more excited about seeing Top Gun Maverick than I was the new Bond movie. I feel I'm just going to out myself on this podcast about how how I felt about Top Gun Maverick.
Your reputation precedes you.
I have to admit, I wasn't expecting an invitation back.
They're called orders, Maverick.
Dogfighting.
Two versus one? Hey, he's got to be kidding.
we think about all these franchises that they've milked dry over the last 30 years that began in the 80s, but it wasn't until we're further along that the serialization of our entertainment really became like the entire focus of the Hollywood business model. So in that way, like, we can look back and say, yeah, it's curious that this movie made so much money and somebody didn't to go ahead with the sequel. At the time, I don't think it was ever expected.
I mean, obviously it's not a sequel. It would be more of a spiritual successor. You know, if you want to consider Tony Scott's Days of Thunder as, you know,
that was just putting Tom Cruise in something else that goes fast.
That man sure does love to he does love to risk his life for entertainment.
He does. And you know, as dumb as it is, I kind of respect him for it.
Oh, I do. New Mission Impossible comes out and they show whatever crazy stunt he's doing, and I'd be like, that's our Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise has suffered an injury while performing a stunt on the set of Mission Impossible 6, but the film is still slated for its release next year. Paramount has confirmed to IGN that Cruise broke his ankle while performing a stunt and that production is halted until he is fully recovered.
It's ironic that you do all these death-defying stunts. And the one that, like, got you was this seemingly innocuous jump across the roof. What was going through your mind when that happened? Let's talk about that day.
I was pissed. I was really angry.
At your foot?
At myself. I just stuck my foot out just a split second too long. I knew instantly I said it's broken.
So did it ever go through your mind, like, I may not run again?
Yeah. I mean, it was, I was nervous about it. I definitely was. But I really tried to work hard. I worked 10 hours a day on rehab, 7 days a week.
Helicopter.
Yes.
You're up there, you're alone, you're spiraling in a ravine. I mean, what goes through your mind when you're doing that?
Don't die. I need to walk on the wire just to catch my breath. I don't know how or where, but I'm going. It's all that I have left. It don't matter where it takes me, long as I can keep this feeling.
We had already been talking about this for a while, and when we first went on quarantine, the New York Times started Watch Party, and the first one they did back on March 24th was Top Gun, and it was chosen because A.O. Scott had never seen it.
Oh, wow.
Can you? He had a take that a kind of perspective that we've come back to on Cinema Shame a few times, and that he said that when he was in his super snobby 20s, so probably, you know, being fed a serious dose of Godard and Antonioni, he said that he would have hated it. So I have a quote from the response article that came later that week. So he said, "What struck me, what I didn't expect, was the extravagant beauty, the dreaminess, the foregrounding of poetry rather than plot. I expected something more like the action movies I'm used to reviewing, a violent, overblown spectacle of aggression, not anything so deliciously campy and sincerely silly." And I think that's perfect. And that really summarizes kind of what we're doing here, and especially as it applies to Top Gun, because people who haven't seen it certainly have expectations. Can you speak to what your expectations going in specifically and how watching the movie changed or didn't live up to those expectations?
Yeah, so I was expecting... Yeah, I don't know what I was. I don't really think I could say I knew what I was expecting. I think I was really just looking for, you know, some cool action dogfights and, you know, stuff like that. And what you really kind of get is it's almost like like an extended, really slick music video, but obviously it's not a music video, but it's definitely shot. It definitely feels like it's shot like one. I'm expecting some cool actions, sequences. The one main action sequence is really at the end. Most of it is just, Maverick and Goose and Iceman doing all their training. And then you have a romance, stuck in the middle. And it's funny because, I restarted rewatching Seinfeld, and it's kind of funny. Top Gun is really like the Seinfeld of action movies, where can you really say what it's really about? not really though. I can imagine George Costanza, with Russell Dalrymple pitching this movie, and he's like, I can give you Top Gun in just one word.
Nothing.
Nothing?
Nothing.
What does that mean?
The show is about nothing.
Buzz, it's not about nothing.
No, it's about nothing.
Well, maybe in philosophy, but even nothing is something.
Mr. Dalrymple, your niece is on the phone.
I'll call back. Dalrymple. Not even close.
It's not like it tries to make the case that it's this thing that it's not. From the minute those opening titles hit, you kind of just get the vibe of what you're going to get. It's just this flashy, star-driven, fun time. It doesn't try to be something more than what it is. And I got to be honest, I respect that when, it's like, hey, we're just going to do this thing, and you're going to have fun with it. I see people's reactions, and I see sometimes people have like these real visceral, real harsh reactions to Top Gun. And having now watched it twice, I wonder why this movie doesn't really try to do anything that would elicit that strong reaction. It's a popcorn movie in the purest sense.
And it's got so many weird little interesting things going on.
Yeah.
And you watch it and you're like, why? Not why in like, why would anyone do that? That's terrible. But why were these the creative decisions made? And I think the focal point of that why argument, and maybe this is why people get turned off, because they can't answer these questions. Like, they want to put Top Gun into a box. And you just can't quite do it. I mean, it fits nice into that just mainstream popcorn actioner. Like, it goes there and it sits just fine. But it's weirder than that. And I think the focal point of all that is the volleyball scene. Right. I mean, you can point to that and go, why? And you can say, oh, well, it's just the 80s. But that's not it either. It made sense in that context, because I remember watching it and not thinking anything of it at 8. Like, well, sure, that they're just going to play volleyball. But now we look at that volleyball scene, and you're going, didn't you see what you were shooting in the way this was edited? We're all very versed in the cinematic language, and to suggest that they didn't know, like Tony Scott didn't know, his editors didn't know what they were doing. Clearly they did. And you're aware of the Quentin Tarantino Top Gun rampage in the movie that nobody knows for any other reason other than it's the movie in which Quentin Tarantino goes on a Top Gun rampage.
No,
you don't?
No.
So there's a movie called Sleep With Me from 1994 in which Quentin Tarantino plays a very small role. He's at a party. So, and at this party, he gets talking about Top Gun. He says, you want subversion on a massive level. You know what one of the greatest fucking scripts ever written in the history of Hollywood is? Top Gun.
It's fucking great. What is Top Gun? You think it's a story about a bunch of fighter pilots?
Yeah, it's about a bunch of guys waving their dicks around.
It is a story about a man's struggle with his own homosexuality. That's serious. That is what Top Gun is about, man. You've got Maverick, all right? He's on the edge, man. He's right on the fucking line, all right? And you've got Iceman and all his crew.
Right.
They're gay. They represent the gay man,
right.
All right? And they're saying, go the gay way. He could go both ways.
What about Kelly McGillis, right?
Kelly McGillis, she's heterosexuality. She's saying, no. Go the normal way. Play by the rules, go the normal way.
Right.
And they're saying, no, go the gay way. Be the gay way. Go for the gay way.
Right.
All right? That is what's going on throughout that whole movie. He goes to her house, right? All right? It looks like they're going to have sex. You know, they're just kind of sitting back. He's taking a shower and everything. They don't have sex. He gets on the motorcycle, drives away. She's like, what the fuck is going on here?
Right.
Next scene you see her, she's in the elevator, she is dressed like a guy. She's got the cap on, she's got the aviator glasses, she's wearing the same jacket that the Iceman wears. She is, okay, this is how I gotta get this guy. This guy's going towards the gay way. So I gotta bring him back. I gotta bring him back from the gay way. So I'm gonna do that through subterfuge. I'm gonna dress like a man, all right? That is how she approaches it.
Right.
Okay. But the real ending of the movie is when they fight the Migs at the end, all right? Because he has passed over into the gay way. They are this gay fighting fucking force, all right? And they're beating the Russians. The gays are beating the Russians, all right? And it's over, and they fucking land. And Iceman has been trying to get Maverick the entire time. Finally, he's got him, all right? And what is the last fucking line that they have together? They're all hugging and kissing and happy with each other. And Ice comes up to Maverick, and he says, man, you can ride my tail anytime.
Yes.
And what does Maverick say? Maverick, you can ride my sword fight! Sword fight! Sword fight!
Now that's a read.
This kind of not so subtextual homosexual subtext really does go kind of through the whole thing in odd ways. I think there's probably a camp of people who can't answer these questions. So these eccentric or unusual creative choices rubs them the wrong way. Maybe they don't like that it doesn't fit in that box quite so readily. Maybe it's because of the huge popularity of the movie. You know, anytime a movie gets that big, it's going to elicit all sorts of reactions that it probably doesn't necessarily deserve. Top Gun probably deserves all these different reactions.
I agree with that. And maybe it's just because of how, you know, movie audiences were in the 80s that, you know, they were just able to accept this, you know, as it is. I mean, I don't believe a movie could get away with being, you know, so sleek and yet sort of almost vapid at the same time. I don't think a movie really could get away with that.
It's interesting because to sell, so a movie has to be good on its own, right? Or it has to be sold through the charisma of its stars. They can overcome a lot. Who is even a true movie star anymore? It's still just Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise.
Really. That's it. And even he can't even sell a movie on his own anymore.
Yeah. Earlier, you know, I mentioned how, you know, this is produced by Don Simpson and Jerry Bruckheimer. And yet, but the funny thing is that even in today's movie climate, that doesn't even carry the same weight, you know, that it once did.
No, I mean, these guys were a brand. I mean, you can't say that about too many producers who, I mean, you knew exactly
what you were getting. Top Gun is definitely the movie. It's what Michael Bay thinks he's making, and 99% of the time it never is.
Let's talk about Tony Scott then. Let's talk about what Tony Scott brought to this production. We've discussed a little bit of it, but how is this movie different in anybody else's hands?
Yeah, it definitely will not. It definitely isn't as, there's definitely not as much flair to it. Tony Scott, I always felt was one of the more underappreciated directors of, you know, action cinema. You know, you'll think of, you know, someone like John McTiernan, Paul Verhoeven, you know, I'm just thinking of people who they might consider sort of the, you know, people who have the masters of the action film, you know, Richard Donner, if you want to, you know, if you want to include the Lethal Weapon films, Tony Scott always kind of, it's crazy, he always kind of flew under the radar with his, you know, with his filmmaking. And I think he gives it exactly, you know, exactly what it needs, because somebody else would have, this thing might have been overloaded on the action, you know, on the action sequences, overloaded on the romance. It really could have been a piece of excess here.
I don't think we ever really appreciated him. He had an incredible string of these pure entertainment movies. And I'm not just talking about box office. But we're at a point now we can look back on his career. I mean, he died in 2012. And the number of movies that we can look back on and say that was a successful piece of entertainment. He also wasn't anything really specific. I mean, he was an action director, and you could say that he favored style and this visceral reaction over the substance of the film. But I've always been wary of that type of depiction, because sometimes style is substance. It becomes so important to the experience of the movie that more substance actually would have detracted. It's interesting because we talked about the Quentin Tarantino scene in that 1994 movie, but Tony Scott directed Top Gun, obviously, but Tony Scott also directed Quentin Tarantino's True Romance script, which was the year before that movie. So part of me really believes that there's a nod and a wink between the two of them. But True Romance, which is, I guess I would consider it my favorite Tony Scott directed movie, but it's kind of easy to forget that that's a Tony Scott, because it's so known as a Quentin Tarantino movie.
I'm seeing what I'm used to seeing visually from Scott, but all around me, what I'm hearing is what I know and love from, you know, from Tarantino. Mm-hmm. That's a very special film there.
I think at the beginning, it was probably not something that Tarantino wanted. I'm sure that he wanted to make that movie, but they weren't going to do it with Tarantino at that point. So, and I used to hold very strongly that Pulp Fiction was the best Tarantino movie, but in the last handful of years, probably 5 years, having rewatched most of Tarantino's work over again, I think True Romance is the best Tarantino movie. And I think part of that's because of the collaboration, what Tony Scott brought to that script. I really think he was underrated in terms of bringing a narrative to screen.
Yes.
And you even look at something like Unstoppable, like his last movie, which did very poorly at the box office, but that is a really entertaining movie in the way that it has a singular purpose. It gets to it, it tells the story, and it's done. And it puts thrusting two movie stars into the center of the film that otherwise could have been rather forgettable. But you've got Denzel and Chris Pine, and they're really good at selling the material. And maybe that's his skill. Maybe the skill is presenting these actors in a way that they can carry movies along with these visuals. Because, again, if it's just the visuals, we're back into that vapidity we were talking about. There's nothing going on. But because it's so entertaining and we enjoy watching movie stars as movie stars, I think that's a really overlooked talent.
Oh, yeah. Even with something like Beverly Hills Cop 2, which you know, the movie as a whole is a step down from the, you know, the classic original. I don't think 2 is as good as the original.
Yeah, but it's stylish as hell. Tony Scott's influence on that movie is noticeable.
And when you add that style with the stardom, it's still a great time. You know, The Last Boy Scout, you know, again, super stylish, great with star power, truth be told. Now, as I'm just going through his his filmography, he's worked with Denzel multiple times, and he's worked with Will Smith and
Eddie Murphy, Tom Cruise, Kevin Costner,
Bruce Willis, and it's just pretty much all of his movies, I've seen just about all of them. Tony Scott's career, it's fascinating because his brother Ridley has probably all the acclaim, but I'd kill to have a filmography like Tony Scott's here.
Yeah. Action direction is kind of a lost art. The big movies that we're getting, I think it's easy to focus on Marvel. But I don't think the action direction is all that great. What those movies do so well is present personality, but the action scenes to me are dull. I know that that sounds strange considering how foregrounded the action is in those movies. But by the time we get to that last third act, Battle Royale and all these movies, I kind of lose interest and I want more of the character things.
There's not really a craftsmanship. Why do people praise, like some of the action that was in Mission Impossible Fallout? It's like, well, truth be told, we don't get that much anymore.
I mean, it's so, really, Mission Impossible is the last, and Bond you can rely on those two series for some of the great stunt work, the practical stunt work, not just CGI manipulation. And Tony Scott, getting back to Top Gun here, knew exactly why this movie was going to play, because you felt like you were in the sky.
Yes.
And we can go all the way back to Wings, the very first Academy Award winner for Best Picture. That was, again, real aerial photography. And that blew people's minds in many of the same ways that when Top Gun hit the big screen and you could feel the energy of an F-14 in your seat. You can't get that with CGI. And that's where we've been going for so long. And we're losing that element of action cinema. And that's why I think we go back to the 80s so frequently. And even the 70s were great for car chases. It has a sense of weight and speed.
You get you feel when you're watching, you feel because you feel like you're in it, and then you also feel the craftsmanship that the filmmakers are putting on display. And it's not like, when I was watching Top Gun that I had that I was sitting there on my couch feeling like I was up in the air. But I don't want to dismiss it like that, but that realism is just something that you can't replicate it. Oh, now here's something I did want to ask you, how important is the soundtrack of Top Gun to the success of the film?
It's huge. It's huge. It was woven so perfectly into this whole brand. And Danger Zone is synonymous with Top Gun. And I one of the things that I go back to, that the sight and sound of 80s movies was just different because the way that they brought new popular music into these movies. They're not just songs pulled from artist records, or they're not B-sides that they weren't going to be used anywhere else. I mean, Kenny Loggins is most famous for his soundtrack work. He released a lot of records, but I don't think anybody cares. I mean, Kenny cares. I'm sure there are people who like Loggins and Messina. But Danger Zone, Footloose, these are songs that are as big as the movie. I was in high school. My dad got a new Grand Cherokee with a fancy stereo system, and it came with a test disc, an audio test disc. The first song on that disc provided by the manufacturer was Danger Zone.
That's awesome.
We went out to the car, sitting in our driveway, and he turned up Danger Zone as loud as we could tolerate. While I don't think the soundtrack sells Top Gun without Top Gun, but I don't think its importance can be overlooked.
You know, it's funny when my first viewing, and I'm hearing Danger Zone, and when you hear it's like towards the, you know, at the end of the film, and it's funny, it was almost sort of transformative to me, even though
context, like you know the song for so long. I mean, this has been it's an omnipresent song, whether you want to hear it or not. You are going to hear Danger Zone. So I can only imagine what it was like to have known Danger Zone for your entire life and then finally put that into context.
I could almost imagine in my mind what it would have been like walking out of, for me growing up, my main theater was in the Cheltenham Mall in Philadelphia. Just growing up, I know what coming out of movies there on Friday nights was like. You know, when I heard the song with the movie, I was like, you know what? I don't even know if this was something my parents saw in theaters. But if they did, I can imagine what it was like for them probably walking out of the theater, that song, to that movie. You know the feeling, especially when you're younger and there's a movie, you just walk out and you're just like, that was just an awesome experience.
It's a whole type of synergy. And now that we're removed from it, and I made up a term called synesthesia nostalgia, because it's, you cannot think of one without the other. And you hear Danger Zone, it instantly recalls nostalgia for the film, just as you're watching Top Gun and you can't get Danger Zone out of your head. There's no way to remove the two. It was 9 times platinum, so 9 million records. Impromptu cinema shame quiz that it would have sounded really good if I had come up with it before the show, but now we're doing it as we go. So the number one selling soundtrack of all time is Your Family Feud style. Which you want to go? How lucky are you feeling?
Alright, I'm going to take a guess. Alright, I'm just going to take a random guess here. I'm going to say, oh, you know what? I don't know why I didn't think of this. I don't know. I don't think the movie was as big as, the movie wasn't as big as Top Gun, or at least people might have thought it was. The Bodyguard.
The Bodyguard is number one, by the way.
Ah, okay.
18 million, but that is strictly because of the actual soundtrack.
Yes, yes.
Nobody thought that highly of the movie.
Yeah, I guess maybe Purple Rain.
Oh, so the Saturday Night Fever was number 2, 16 million copies. Purple Rain was number 3, 13 million copies. And then is when I just don't understand what happens, because number 4 is Forrest Gump.
But that's interesting.
What? It's just the songs of the era, right? I mean,
yeah.
It's like Jefferson Airplane, right? And then the rest of the list makes total sense, because you've got Dirty Dancing at number 5. Titanic at number 6, because everyone apparently needed to own My Heart Will Go On.
See, that's what I was always surprised. I was like, see, I love the score. I love the score to Titanic. I didn't realize that people really bought the soundtrack for that one song.
Yep. Lion King is number 7.
Really?
Yep. Mm. Then Footloose and Top Gun are tied with 9 million. And if you can guess number 10, you win the internet for today.
I don't know. Space Jam? That was a popular soundtrack.
That is an amazing guess. I do not know where that falls on the list. Is it on here? It is on there. It's number 16, 6 million copies.
Oh, wow, that's quite a bit.
It is. It is. That was a good guess. Number 10 is Oh Brother, Where Art Thou?
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right.
Because bluegrass made bluegrass popular for a really hot minute in 2000.
That one, like, album of the year at the Grammys.
Yeah.
I've never seen that movie, but you know, that was something that I was surprised. I was like, that's the album of the year?
Yeah, and then a movie I would have thought the soundtrack was higher is Grease was at 11. I thought Grease would have sold more copies, but that is there.
Oh, wow, outside the top 10.
Yeah.
The soundtrack era is something, it's something I wish we could get again. That was such a huge part of the movie experience. We got a real jam going down. Welcome to the Space Jam. Here's your chance. Do your dance at the Space Jam. All right. All right.
Oh, before I forget, and we can wrap this up, this has been a fantastic conversation. We've run in and out of Top Gun a little bit, but that's why you listen to us, isn't it? So I posted to Twitter today. I asked if anybody had any questions for my guest who had yet to see or who had just watched Top Gun. And we can start with our Cinema Shame co-founder here, Campbell Dropout. He asked, you have to pick one, and we'll make this. You can only have one filmography. Is it Tony or Ridley Scott?
Oh, God. I know I just said that if I made movies, I would love to have Tony Scott's, to have a filmography like Tony Scott's, and it's a really solid one. But Ridley Scott gave us Alien.
Yeah.
And Alien is so amazing. And Ridley's had a lot of, he's had some hits and some misses in his career, you know, but he's had a lengthy career. And so, you know, you're going to have that, but when you have Alien and that's your second film ever. And it's one of the greatest science fiction, one of the greatest horror films ever. That covers a lot for me.
Yeah, it's hard. You know, I think there are more Tony Scott movies that I enjoy, and I think I own more Tony Scott movies in my collection. You know, you've got Alien there, headlining. It's top 10 for me. It's hard to turn down Ridley. And he's got some underrated gems in his roster as well. So
Black Rain.
It's solid. 1989. All right. Next, we had Angela Knight at Angel Heart Knight on Twitter. She asked, do you think that Maverick or Iceman is the more dangerous pilot, being that it's Iceman's jet wash from failing to fire or clear in time that causes Goose's death?
I still probably just got to go. It's so funny. The most tragic part of the movie is actually the one time it's not Maverick's fault. But Maverick is still, but throughout the movie, Maverick has proven to be reckless, you know. So I think, you know, I think, and I can't even remember specifically how that whole situation really occurred. But I never really thought Iceman was, you know, a danger, you know, was a danger to anybody. It's just unfortunately the one tragic thing that happened. It, you know, that's so interesting about Top Gun. Maverick is a reckless mess most of the time, and the one time there's an actual accident, it actually wasn't his fault. Who knew? But the movie somehow manages to pull that off.
All right. And our last one, this one is from Jill Writes, at Jill Writes. It's a visual cue, so I just tagged you on her response, so you'll have to pull it up on Twitter yourself.
Oh, I see.
She asks, okay, do you like my jacket?
Yes, I do.
I thought it was a solid jacket. I'm a little envious of the jacket.
Yeah.
And I'll put this on the page just so listeners at home can see the jacket.
That's something, or at least, I don't know if it's just because I wasn't, noticed that zeitgeist then. And I mean, you're a little bit older than me, so maybe you did. I'm surprised. Was Maverick's jacket, was that a thing, you know, after the release of Top Gun?
Yeah, there were more bomber jackets around.
Oh, okay. I was going to say, because I said, you know, at the time, I was only a year old when this came out, so I didn't know if, you know, if the bomber jacket, if that was like the Michael Jackson Thriller jacket, you know, if that was something that everybody had to have.
Yeah, you know, they were about. It didn't last all that long, if I remember correctly, but they were definitely out. And one thing I was thinking of, did you see Hot Shots?
No, I have never seen Hot Shots.
Somewhere in the Mediterranean, on this naval aircraft carrier, these men have been selected to write a page in military history. They are the best the Navy and Air Force have to offer. They've been brought together to form an elite squad of fighter pilots. Their mission, one of national security and international concern. These are the fearless pilots.
Seems no matter what I do, I end up hurting someone.
The men who command them.
Pudding?
No, thank you, sir.
I'll do my best.
And the women who love them.
Stay.
Charlie Sheen.
Never wanted to be a horse so much in my life.
Lloyd Bridges. Call them the best of the best. Call them...
Eddie's.
Hot Shots. The mother of all movies.
Oh, God, I love this country.
It's solid, and Charlie Sheen has always had a natural gift for this kind of comedy. Watch Men at Work if you haven't, everyone out there. That'll be your new cinema shame requirement for next week. But Hot Shots is a surprisingly effective parody of Top Gun. And then Hot Shots Part Deux totally changes course and makes fun of Rambo.
Oh, that's a...
And it's not hard. It doesn't do anything that Weird Al didn't do in UHF, really. But it's like that for 90 minutes. So if you think you can get tired of that joke, you don't. You just don't. I think it's kind of been forgotten in recent years.
I definitely remember the seeing commercials and, you know, for it back in the day and all that. I remember Part Deux more just because of that image of Sheen with the chicken.
Yep, chicken.
The chicken arrow, chicken in the bow.
Yep. And then it explodes, obviously.
Yeah, I'll definitely check that out. Because that's something that I'm kind of thinking about. You know, I'm surprised. I was like, yeah, Top Gun is definitely something that would be parodied. And I would imagine
it took them a few years to get around to it too. And I think part of the reason is because it's already kind of aware of itself. I think this goes back to, doesn't it have to be aware of itself? So it's a little bit trickier to parody. So Hot Shots has to do a little bit more than just point and laugh. My notes are exhausted. Do you have any final words to anyone out there in Cinema Shame Land who might be considering their first time watch of Top Gun?
It's so earnest. Like, it's just so earnest in its cheesiness. You were just born after 1989, and you just want to be like, what were the 80s like? You know, you'd be like, just watch Top Gun. And be like,
it's a time capsule movie. It really is.
Yeah. And just, you know,
for better and worse,
just have fun with it. You know, you might not get, you know, 10 essays out of Top Gun, or you may. That's the beauty of it. You know, it's such, I don't want to say it's a cipher, but it's just, I don't think I've come across a blockbuster like it before. I said earlier, it's kind of like the Seinfeld of blockbusters, of action blockbusters. I don't know how it manages to get away with really kind of not doing anything, but it does. But it works, and
it's a lot of misdirection.
Like when I watched it the second time, it pacing wise, it moved a whole lot quicker. I mean, it did the first time, but it did maybe just because I was familiar with it by now. But like, you know, you're watching and you're just like, man, this thing moves. This thing really moves. And then you'll be like, oh, I'm at this scene. Wait, what led up to what led to this moment? I don't remember, and it doesn't really matter. But you get there, and it's a fun ride. Yeah, it's something special.
I think that's a good way to close out the show. It is just Top Gun. And I thank you for coming on and sharing your Top Gun experience with us all. I'm glad to finally get you on here.
I'm so happy to be here.
Everybody, stay safe out there. Stay home. Watch all the movies you've been putting off. Now is absolutely the time. Stop binging crap just because it's on Netflix. Pull out that watch pile. Turn on the Criterion Channel. find something that you've always wanted to watch or you've always felt like you needed to watch. Expand all the types of movies you're watching. Try something new. We have so much content available to us right now, and now is the time to enjoy all of it.
Of cinema.
You have chosen wisely.